Welcome back to Sister Circle Live. Our next guest was the inspiration behind the Lifetime movie, I Am Somebody's Child, the Regina Louise Story. It was through her perseverance and unwavering commitment she was able to get this film made. Let's take a look.
You're a ward of the state.
What's that mean?
Nobody loves.
You, you're not going to be alone.
Could you lend a hand?
The girl needs behavioral correction. What she needs is a loving home. If you really care about that girl, you will sever the bond.
Wow, please welcome to the show, Regina Louise.
Yes.
That just almost made me.
Yeah,
man. That almost took me out.
Almost took me out. Yeah. Stopped it right there.
Well, Regina, we're so happy to have you here today, and we really want to just talk candid to you about the foster care system and the gaps that a lot of kids fall through. You were in over 30 different homes. First of all, how did you come into foster care?
My father at the time worked for Barry White, and he had an opportunity to take his own music and play it forward. And come on, we all know the opportunities that are so limited for African American people. So he had a choice: pursue the music, take care of my child. He pursued his dream, and I can't be mad at him for it. So I turned myself into the system because I thought there's no one here to take care of me.
Your mother was not present.
She could not do it. She did not have the faculties to be a mother.
Man. Oh my God. Just watching this clip was heartbreaking. Just the clip in itself almost like brought me to tears. A lot of the things that you went through were depicted in this film. The lack of self-love, the constant moving around, and even this piece about your behavior, you know, seeing that. Talk to us about the resilience that you had to have to get through this situation. I mean, this is the strength of Job. This is the strength of Job, seriously.
So I remember being a little girl and sitting in the pew at Sunday school, and I remember the Reverend saying, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And in that moment, I believed. So that's where my resilience came from. At the end of the day, if Jesus could come back after 3 days, then I could come back after
Praise
anything.
God. Yes, oh, God. Right
now. Yeah. No, that's good. That's good. That's good. That's good.
My God.
In your case, in one of the foster homes you were in, the girls' home, your foster mom, Jean, she wanted to adopt you, but they would not allow her to because you were an African-American child. So my question to you is, number one, how did that affect you, and how did it affect your opinion on interracial adopting?
It was devastating because I didn't see it as binary, as black and white. I saw it as a mother who wanted me, who loved me, who imprinted upon me, someone who saw me. At the end of the day, all of you, I imagine, were seen by your mother or a caretaker, someone who loved you, and it helped you blossom. She helped me blossom. So if you're saying, I'm not worthy of being loved for, cared for, what are my chances? It wrecked me. It devastated me.
And you had the, you were able to reunite with her years later. How did that come about, and how did you feel?
I wrote a book with the intention of finding her. Someone found her. I was on CNN. Someone found her. They called me up and said, they called her up rather, and said, Regina's looking for you. She wrote a book about you. And then I left the Tavis Smiley Show, and he was like, what do you want? I said, someone to tell me they're proud of me, Tavis. Next thing I know, I receive an email. I'm so proud of you, sweetheart.
Oh my God.
After 30 years, y'all bet, I was. I don't even have words for it.
Now, Regina, you had a coping mechanism by the name of Charlie.
Oh, see?
Talk to us about Charlie.
Y'all aren't playing. Charlie is my, it's like, he's my object permanence. So Charlie is, I teach myself still that love exists and it stays even when I can't see it, even when there's no apparent evidence. So Charlie is my self-soother. He, when I feel lonely, even as an adult, I can go to Charlie and he reminds me that love is never wasted. Love is here. You are good. All is well.
Wow. You wrote the book. You made the film.
Yes. 20 years saying no. 20 years of then saying there's no black girl available to play you. I said, well, I will wait for her to be born. And the little girl who plays me, Angela Fairley, was 2 years old, baby, when I originally started getting this movie optioned 17 times. I said, we don't take no for an answer here. Every no is my yes.
Right.
I
know we're going to hear more. We're going to keep Regina for the show. So we'll be right back with this amazing woman to tell more about her amazing story. Welcome back to Sister Circle Live. Regina Louise is still with us, sharing her story about the foster care system and so much more.
Right. And really quickly, Regina, I want to talk to you about aging out. It's a real thing. So from what I read, basically you came of age, they gave you a garbage bag with your things in it and bid you farewell, and that was it.
23,000 children age out a year with a glad garbage bag with nowhere to go, and only one out of two will ever get a job and keep it. 1% attend college and maybe survive it. At the end of the day, I see it this way. A rabbi from the first millennial said, his name was Rabbi Hillel, if I am not for myself, who will be? So for every foster child, be for yourself. Get a hold of a who's who in America, track those people, find out the milestones of their success, and do what you can to be your own mentor to get yourself where you want to be. If it's meant to be, it's up to me. That's how I see it.
It's good. If it's meant to be, it's up
Thank
to
you
me.
Thank you for sharing such an important story with us and with our viewers. For more on this amazing woman, you can follow her on Instagram at The Real Regina Louise. Thank you.